One of the most important features on the Bob White's landscape is the availability of good midday coverts, sometimes called loafing coverts, what we call quail houses. You ought to have a good quail house about every softball throw apart on the landscape. Here's a great example of a quail house. This one happens to be catclaw acacia. It's any kind of shrub about the size of your cab or your pickup that's dense above, open at ground level, makes a good blueprint for a quail house. It needs to be dense from above to keep the hawks off of you, but at ground level, you ought to be able to see those ground-dwelling predators that are approaching. So those are the criteria. Unfortunately, a lot of our country doesn't have these really nice quail houses, so we're forced to try to make the best of a bad situation. We're going to show you how to do that with some mesquite regrowth by a process we call half-cutting. One of the things you got to decide is which trees do you want to half-cut. This is a poor example. Not very many stems. It's upright in its growth form. The cowboy would say, that's the kind I want to save if I'm going to save mesquite. From a quail standpoint, this is the worst possible mesquite out there. I wouldn't care if we got rid of this one. Let's look for a better candidate to half-cut. Ah, now here's a better looking candidate. I like this one because it has more stems, it has smooth bark, and therefore when we bring in the saw and start half cutting, these limbs will be more likely to survive than if they were older limbs. The older limbs with the scaly bark, the broken bark, half cutting will kill those limbs. We don't want to kill this tree, we just want to wound it. The tools that you need for half-cutting mesquites are very inexpensive. You've probably got one in the garage. If not, you can pick one up for about $8. Just your basic limb saw and a pair of gloves is handy too. I'm gonna let Jacob, one of our summer interns from Arkansas, he's gonna show us how to half-cut a mesquite. He's gonna cut about halfway through that limb, and then that limb is just gonna drape down and he's just gonna move around. Keep moving around that tree like that until it looks like a series of broken wagon spokes. And by doing that, again, our goal is we hope we haven't killed that limb. We hope that limb to survive, and it will continue to grow in that fashion downward to where we're trying to simulate that good classical quail house. Now, a good time to be half-cutting is anytime the sap is flowing, anytime those limbs are supple. I think anytime from April through mid-June is typically a good time to half-cut mesquites. And again, it doesn't take you very long. I don't recommend cutting a single tree. I recommend that you cut a series of maybe 8 or 10 over the size of a basketball court. You never want to do anything on the landscape that tells your predators where you're at. If there's only one tree that's like that, chances are a hawk will know where you're at. So you want to be able to confuse your predators. So don't ever cut just one, cut a number of them in one location. We leave one or two of the limbs in the center of the tree. I think that increases the survival of that tree and it also allows it to continue to grow up. So we've learned to leave a couple of those limbs in the middle of the tree. In order to maximize the number of quail we can produce on a piece of property, we gotta maximize what we call usable space. We gotta make sure every inch of our ranch is quail habitat. So much of the properties here in West Texas have conservation reserve program on them. Set aside acreage that's grown up in mesquites, not very quail friendly. So again, we're trying to simulate those better quail houses, make it more usable by producing quail houses like these through that process of half cutting.